Hello, true believers. This is Doc Hogg, and welcome to episode 26 of Comics and Variety. If you like this channel, please do subscribe, hit the notification bell to stay up to date on new videos, and as always, hit the like button. If you wish to contact me, you can email me at dhogg70@gmail.com or via Twitter. My Twitter handle is @doc_hogg. Now, before I discuss the Netflix movie Silence, I want to quickly mention a documentary called The Perfect Bid, The Contestant Who Knew Too Much. It follows an obsessive fan of The Price is Right game show, Ted Slauson, who records the prices of every item on the show and memorizes them. Here's a clip.
My brother and I think, both noticed, oh, well, I remember the price of this was $1,500 or whatever. It would be $1,500 again, and so that kind of inspired me to start kind of tracking prices or, you know, keeping records, if you will. When I would record the shows and put it all in a Word doc and everything and put it in the database, pretty much every show I had to add 4 or 5 new things because they were always bringing new stuff on.
This documentary traces his experiences from audience member to contestant up to the point that Drew Carey took over the show from Bob Barker. It also examines the history of the show from some of the people who worked on it over the years. It's good. It's a light, fun documentary, and best of all, it's just over an hour long, so it won't take you much time. It's short and it's very enjoyable, and I would highly recommend it. Now then, okay, Netflix's movie Silence. It stars Stanley Tucci, Miranda Otto, and John Corbett, and it is directed by Suzanne Beer. And I need to emphasize, do not watch this movie. Certainly don't make time to see it. And if you have a free afternoon and are just, you know, looking through through Netflix, don't watch it then either. Watch something else or just find some wet paint and watch it dry. I mean, this movie just... I mean, I wouldn't force my dog to watch this movie, and I don't own a dog. Now, this movie is based on a book by Tim Leben. Apparently, Tim Leben survived Thanos' snap, so I'm hoping one of the Avengers can go back in time, eliminate Mr. Leben, so there is no book and there is no movie, and I will never watch it. I'd be happy with that. Okay, so this is what the YouTube channel Looper had to say about Silence.
Based on the 2015 novel, The Silence probably has a familiar premise to anyone who's seen A Quiet Place. A group of people are trying to stay alive in a world infested by monsters who hunt by sound. But surface similarities aside, there are a lot of new ideas in The Silence that are going to make it worth watching. The story centers on a young woman, played by Sabrina's Kiernan Shipka, who winds up on the wrong side of a gang of cultists. Check it out on April 12th.
Too bad that it didn't rip off A Quiet Place. Then you might have had some semblance of an actual movie. Oh, and the title of that YouTube video? Everything Good Coming to Netflix in April 2019. The plot of this movie involves creatures called Vesps that can fly, but they can't see. They use, presumably, echolocation. They're able to move around and locate using sound. And they have been trapped in a sealed-off cave for thousands of years, and then these two dopes open the cave, and the Vesps fly out and start eating everything that makes a sound, including humans. And this is what a Vesp looks like. What exactly is that? To me, it looks like the Demogorgon and a movie piranha got together and had a kid. The lead in this movie is played by Stanley Tucci, and my God, he must have really needed the money. He is so miscast in this movie. He is supposed to play the strong father type, and it's like the producers didn't take a look at the other guy who was in this movie for that part. Tucci, who has played some great parts in his time, is absolutely terrible in this. The Vesp's wingspan is longer than the wider than the emotional range that Tucci has. For example, here's a clip of him getting out of the car and trying to walk quietly so as to not trigger the Vesps. Does he show any fear, anxiety, or terror? No, none of the emotions that you need in a horror movie. So he's miscast. Miranda Otto, who I've liked since Lord of the Rings, is completely wasted in this movie, as is John Corbett, as is just about everyone involved in this movie, and if I didn't have a stick up my ass about having watched this piece of cinematic crap, I wouldn't be wasting my time or your time with this review. Then there are the plot holes in this movie, of which there are quite a few. For starters, the Vesps come out of a cave that has been sealed off. Then we learn this about the Vesps.
They said that Vesps don't like intense cold. People above the Arctic Circle, they're surviving. There's footage of dead Vesps and snowdrifts.
I've been in a few caves in my lifetime. And most of them are rather cool, if not cold. Now, if you've spent thousands of years surviving in a cave and evolving in a cave, it would seem likely that one of the first things you would develop is a tolerance for the cold. In fact, you'd probably thrive in cold areas. Maybe not Antarctica, but at least Canada. Okay, next, here is the biggest plot hole. After watching this scene, my thought was, hey, Tucci, get on your cell phone. Text the world that you have found a way to beat the Vesps. It won't take too long. You can still get your family to that cold place. Now, to be fair, maybe Tucci isn't familiar with things like wood chippers, shredders, mulchers, and so forth. Or maybe he doesn't know where to get one, making it hard to advise other people. Hey, I'm not judging here. I don't care for yard work myself. But I do know where to find some of these things, so let me give him some help. These places have a lot of things that can be used to kill the Vesps. But of course, the Tucci character doesn't tell anyone about this discovery, and the movie just kind of plods on after that. And they encounter something called the Tongueless Cult. I'm not even going to bother with that. Just trust me on this. That was stupid beyond belief. And again, please, don't watch this movie. Don't waste your time on it. You'll just end up wishing you could have that time back. Okay. That music means that it is time for Hogg's Headlines, all the news that Doc Hogg wants to report on. Dateline, how to take the joy out of movies. Writing in The Wrap, Carlos Aguilar complains about the animated film The Secret Life of Pets Part 2, moaning that the movie offers outdated messages about marriage and manliness. He writes that The Secret Life of Pets 2 effectively acts as an animated ode to heteronormativity, toxic masculinity, and patriarchal worldviews, passed off as harmless plot points to entertain. Hey, Carlos! Newsflash! Sometimes harmless plot points are just that. This clown then continues Pets 2's descent into the bowels of what reads as conservative messaging begins as Katie, voiced by Ellie Kemper, Max's owner, randomly meets a young man, quickly marries, and has a child. In this fictional universe, that's clearly the only natural progression of events in a woman's life. That trope is later reinforced through the pet characters. Let's see, a woman wants to get married and have kids. Where could the writers and producers of this film have gotten that heinous idea? Could it be, I don't know, looking at the world around them? Finally, he whines, in case it wasn't obvious, Pets 2 makes no attempt at diversifying the notion of what a family is today. No same-sex couples are in sight as pet owners, much less as parents. Nothing that deviates from the default straight married couple is even hinted at.
Aww.
You know, I have not yet taken my 3-year-old to the theater to see a movie. This will be his first. Dateline, fake comic book news. If you want to know why Donald Trump has had so much success in attacking the media, take a look at this interview with comic book writer Christopher Priest, conducted by Chris Arendt for the website Newsarama. Priest has written for comics such as Deathstroke and Black Panther and is now working on Vampirella. He did an interview with Arendt about Vampirella, and then Arendt decided to go all SJW on Priest and follow up with questions that tried to create controversy. For example, in an answer that Priest gave in the initial interview, he said, quote, "It's like the world woke up in the last few years and realized we actually have two genders and both of them mattered." Arendt later emailed this question. Quote, "In another response, you state, it's like the world woke up in the last few years and realized we actually have two genders and both of them matter, while not assuming your intent one way or another. It seems it overlooks genders outside the male-female paradigm. Can you speak to that?" And Priest responded, "Gender, noun, 1. Either of the two sexes, male and female, especially when considered with reference to social and actual cultural differences rather than biological ones." It was a simple interview. I was promoting a comic book, and as a really busy writer, I was typing really fast and speaking honestly while engaging with you. What I won't do, not even for my own safety, is censor myself or try and anticipate every horrible way someone might choose to misinterpret something I've written or said. If anything, that just makes my point for me about how free speech is being compromised. Well, good for Priest. He took Arendt's idiotic question. Is that actually Chris Arendt? Okay, yeah. That's a much better photo of Arendt. Okay, anyways, Priest took the idiotic and loaded question and, in effect, told Arendt to go stick it. Well done, sir. I'm not going to spend much more time on this. I'll provide a link to the interview and a response article from Bounding Into Comics in the description below. I would also take a look at the follow-up question Arendt had regarding a comment Priest made about Joe Biden. That one is a real doozy. Alrighty, that's all for now. Thanks for watching, and unless you are Chris Arendt, have a very nice day.